We've done the greatest thing that man has ever done. We've been to the moon. Nobody can top it. Where do you go when you get to the top of the mountain?
The Visitors Information Center at Cape Kennedy presents a carefree front. But as the tourists stare dutifully at 10 years of space history, NASA, the National Aeronautical and Space Administration, is anxiously campaigning for their souls. For the years since the first moon landing have been lean ones, years of cutbacks, delays and cancellations. The £10,000 million Apollo program ends in December. And then there is only Skylab, a manned orbiting laboratory. But the Skylab astronauts will be the last men in space. After next year, there are only plans and dreams. But the shuttle has yet to be approved by Congress. It could be delayed or even cancelled. No such fear, though, must reach the tourist.
The message you get here about the shuttle is the same as the message you get about everything else. This voice, for instance, tells you that just as in the last 10 years, space technology has brought great benefits in terms of wealth, peace and health to the nation, so the next 10 years are going to bring even greater benefits to the whole of mankind. You'll never guess from listening or seeing anything in here that the Apollo program had had a sharp cutback, that half the workforce here had been laid off and half of that which is left is due to be laid off. And even more, you'll never guess that the Kennedy Space Center is at this moment fighting for its very existence.
NASA speaks with an interminably optimistic voice. No murmur of doubt, no whisper of worry must mar the tourist view of Cape Kennedy. NASA, they must understand, is forever heading upward and outward, and they, the people, are cordially invited to join in worship at the shrine of American space technology.
On our right, once again, is the actual launch pad where Ellen Shepard was launched from. Freedom 7, May 5th, 1961, Commander Ellen B. Shepard aboard. America's first man in space.
Astronauts, no longer mere men, have become gilded demigods on a roll call of honor stretching across the decade. Shepard and Glenn, Armstrong, Aldrin and Collins, men destined to reassert America's supremacy in space. For the program, the space race, started in the Cold War. America had been shocked and frightened by the Russian Sputnik. Her power, prestige and military might had been threatened. Now, supremacy restored, the tourists are blithely asked to worship too before America's military arsenal, on show before them. Here, rocketry is all. For Atlas, Redstone, Skybolt and Polaris, the world's most effective weapons of mass destruction, were created by the same technology and the same industry that brought forth Apollo. But now the moon's been conquered, the American people are listening more and more to the increasingly insistent voices of NASA's critics, to men like Dr. Ralph Lapp, the distinguished nuclear scientist. What are his first thoughts about the Apollo program?
How much it cost? I think that's my first thought. I do think of the fact, and no person on this planet can look at such an achievement as landing men on the moon, bringing them back, without a great deal of awe and pride in the event. So I think those would be my two reactions. I also think, and this is a very private thought, about the time, and it's now rather remote in history, in August of 1960, when a young man by the name of Senator John F. Kennedy wanted advice on what kind of a space program he should have if he should get to be president, which he then hoped he would be. And I headed up a group of some five or six advisory scientists and wrote up a 13-page report in which it actually spelled out three programs, one of which was designed to land men on the moon, which we said was a political objective, not to be based on its scientific or technical merits, which would cost $27 billion.
Why was it that the scientists went along with it?
Oh, I think the scientists were not the decision makers. The scientists simply tagged along, but the astronauts and the engineers have always been king in the National Aeronautics and Space Administration and still are. Science always came last.
For as the audiences die away, so too does the coverage. The man who above all brought space into the living rooms of the United States is Walter Cronkite, America's most famous television commentator. How important was television to the success of the Apollo program?
They learned very early on that they couldn't support a program of this immensity, $26 billion for the moon landing program, without a great deal of public support. And in order to get that public support, obviously you use the most powerful medium that man has yet devised for communications, and that's television. And they used it very well.
What was your own view of the Apollo program?
I think that it was quite important as a morale factor for the American people in a period of rather disastrous domestic and some international events. We had this thing going for us, at least. I think this is important to mankind as well as to the Americans, to people all over the world. There was this new development, this hope that man did have within him, the possibilities to escape his environment. If we can escape in that way, we can escape in other ways. As we, many of us, said in Apollo 11 coverage, that, well, if man can go to the moon, man can do anything.
Well, I think that the media, I would call this the Cronkite effect, the Walter Cronkite television show, which followed the whole space program step by step, did much to support NASA. I guess Mr. Cronkite may be called the patron saint of the space agency. And it was a new thing, so that one could say the television media were justified in giving it prominence. I think it was overplayed myself, and led, this overplay by the media led to its downfall. At the present time, we have much less interest in the space program, I think because of excessive interest at one time. Human nature is like that. You get all excited about something because it's new, and then, you know, ho-hum a few days later.
Do you think that the public were deceived? Is that what you're saying, in a sense, or not?
Well, the public wasn't deceived. It deceived itself. But the media were the pipers of this deception, if you want to call it that. I think that there was the inherent assumption that space was somehow rather tremendously valuable, that it would have just a golden outpouring, a dumping up of the cornucopia, which endless good would come for man. And the space agency has played that theme God knows how long. I'm not denying that there are some good things come from spending $44 billion in the past 10 years. In fact, I believe it's beyond the capability of a federal agency to spend that much money without doing some good.
Yes, NASA's your man. Whoever you are, whatever you do, NASA has something for you. Roll up, take your seat, bend an ear to the voices in the booths, and you too will become a NASA man. At least, that's what NASA hopes. The spin-offs from space are now NASA's most publicized justification for the spending of the last 10 years. And as the agency wants more billions in the coming decade, it speaks in earnest. It may sound coy, but it's a remarkably simple, hard sell.
How important is the public's reaction to space, to your programs, to what you're trying to do?
In my opinion, it is very important. It is the important factor. Without the public support, we will not continue our effort. And as my conviction is that when people understand what space is all about and what it offers for mankind, it will support it very strongly. And so at the present time, our efforts are directed to educate the public, to tell the public. I avoid the word teach, to make plain what it all is that space can return to mankind, and even what is required for the next 100 years, that space is a required tool or we cannot survive. This type of convincing evidence will be presented to the public, and the public will react positively to it. This is, I'm convinced, will be happening.
I think the political space complex is currently making a great effort to get us to buy this space shuttle, for example. This is the next new venture in space, and I would say that the basic reason for it is that NASA, which has enjoyed a budget in excess of $3 billion for many years, doesn't want to see the budget fade. And as it looks around for things to do in space, it can't go to Mars. The moon is passé. The only place they can go is in orbit. And that means you have a choice of either unmanned or manned. Well, as NASA made an inventory of the things it could shoot up into orbit, it turns out that nothing is expensive enough, really, that you could justify a $3 billion program for. So you have to bring man in the act, and you don't know what he's worth, even after all these many flights. Man's value in space is highly doubtful.
The sheer technological virtuosity of the Vehicle Assembly Building is overwhelming. The largest building in the world, erected solely for Apollo. Here, man's technology has put man in his place, a mere speck in a fantasy world, dwarfed into insignificance. The work here demands skill and dedication. 4 years ago, the workforce at Cape Kennedy numbered 28,000. Now it's 14,000. Soon it'll be halved again, and after that, who knows?
But when you get to the end of the program, as we are now, and you see your friends being laid off, people who've done their good job, and you see this kind of thing happening, it makes you wonder when you're going to get it. Well, this tends to make the morale lower. And morale is interest in your job. So I would say the overall interest in a man's job is decreased as a result of this kind of a thing happening.
And how does that show itself?
Well, the guys you work with used to be a team. Hail fellow, well met, this kind of thing. Well, they're not quite as friendly anymore. They're more withdrawn into their own problems, into their own social problems, their family, their income. I would say they lose some attention to their job. The details that they used to worry about, well, they're not so important anymore.
Can you give an example of what you mean when you say that morale has gone down?
Well, I think the things that I see most are the response to a plea for help. You get a phone call from the control room where they're doing spacecraft checkout, and a fellow worker says, hey, I've got a problem with a battery voltage is not correct. Well, this battery voltage is 6 miles away in a spacecraft. Normally, in 1969-70, when the program was going full swing, there'd be two guys jump up and dash over to help rectify the problem. Well, now a guy would say, yeah, I'll be there shortly after I've had my coffee. Or perhaps he'll go to the restroom before he goes over there. I don't believe he feels the dedication that we felt in 1969. Because there's no feeling that I know of other than having a newborn son that'll make you feel like the night I felt when that man stepped on the moon. Because I had a piece of it in my pocket. I was a part of it. When he stepped on that, when he said, you know, I can't remember what he said. This is one small step for a man. One large leap, one giant leap for mankind. Well, I really felt that way. I really did.
Did you expect at that stage that the manned flights would go on, that you were part of something that was going to grow and develop?
Well, when that happened, we had flights out through Apollo 20 or 21. At the rate of two a year, it was 1975. Then there was no overlap between the Apollo program and the space shuttle program and the Skylab. It was one continual effort. But that's not there anymore. They've sort of pulled the rug out from under the Apollo program. We got there, you know, wow. That's the way the politicians are saying now. Well, we've made it, so what?
Do your workmates resent the fact of the rundown?
I think there are some people that do, because they feel that the money that was pulled out of the Apollo program was like a stab in the back. They gave a commitment to do a job. But once the job was partially fulfilled, out goes the rug. We pull the money and put it over here. There's a little saying, it says, how soon we forget. You get to the top of the mountain and you're there. You look around, so what? Here I am. That's a typical American attitude. Find me another mountain and I'll go climb it. They need a challenge. I haven't got a challenge. At work, socially, there is none. What else can you do? Do you know of a challenge?
Today, class, we're going to discuss sulfur oxides and some of the effects that we know that they produce. Today,
15 miles from Cape Kennedy, a handful of engineers laid off from the Space Center are doggedly seeking an alternative challenge out of America's latest obsession, pollution. About turned from space, they're learning to apply their engineering skills to the problems of the environment. This, so the government-sponsored course repeatedly informs them, is the new challenge. With no other work around, they have little alternative.
Now, obviously, if we could get all the natural gas we wanted for a competitive price, we would not need sulfur oxide emissions.
Did any of you feel or think a year ago that you were going to end up back in the classroom, Royce?
No, no. No, I'd have to say that. I haven't. A year ago, that was the last thing that crossed my mind. Was going back to, especially in environmental.
What's it like?
Well, it's just like, I can remember back when I was a teenager, and I'm 42 now, and trying to get back and start back to in a routine of studying and this kind of stuff is rather hard, especially when you've got a lot of your family and all this that you have to, other things, outside interests that you have.
What sort of problems does it create for you?
Well, it's just get the cobwebs out of here. You know, there's a certain technique, I guess we have better when we're young, that the brain gets a little bit hard, I guess. It don't want to absorb some new things. You find out just how dumb you are when you start going to school.
Everything has ended for me when the program ended. I don't visualize ever going back to it, not after the amount of years and time I put into it. But I'm 40, and I've got a boy at home that's 18, and we're both starting out on the same foot. We're both going to college. We're both starting out on new careers. So you got to feel a little bit let down. And when I got laid off, I worked at a gas station for a while, and sold rugs, anything to make a living. Along comes the school. It's just like a rejuvenation in the body.
Do you find it easy to believe in what you're being taught here? To really believe in it?
No, I think that'll be kind of hard, because I had a lot of faith in what I was doing before, and it didn't seem to pay off. Otherwise, I'm not as happy about the whole thing as maybe the rest of the guys are. You lose a home, you lose a car, you lose everything you've got. You know, you got to start over from scrape. I got 6 children at home. And it's just hard to really get rolling and build up faith or any drive or motivation towards anything.
The thrill of watching a gigantic rocket move off into space is it's difficult to find something to compare with it. And I think perhaps a lot of us have had to resolve this in our minds that these other jobs that are to be done are just as important. And I think with the ecology programs that they've had, and the environmentalists have brought it to the front of the world eye now, that we'd better be thinking about our own little spaceship right here now if we want to survive.
I think this all stems back to the question that, you know, is space so important or is the Earth so important? We've realized that we had to reorganize our priorities and take this planet Earth into consideration and bolster ourselves up here, because if we don't, we're faced with one other possibility: either push that space program very enthusiastically to where we can move everybody from this planet to another inhabitable planet when this one dies, or we can stay right here and get down, put our nose to the grindstone, and straighten out what we have already and keep it what it's been.
See, I mean, this has been a way of life. You start out on a project, and you work the project till it's end, and when the project ends, you move over to another one.
And there's always, up to now, been another one?
Always been another one up to this point. Nothing will ever match what the experiences I've had.
Is there anyone who would disagree with that around here?
I think the first time anything as big as that happens, it's hard to compare it to anything that's going to come afterwards. Because that was the first time, and that was the best time.
To the outside world, NASA reveals few doubts or worries, even though no manned flights or Apollos or Saturn V's are scheduled beyond next year, and the VAB will be empty. Even so, NASA maintains a lofty faith.
Man has gone always where men could go. There was always was a frontier, and men did go there. And you can start with the caves. When you started to explore the next environment, you can go to the continents, you can go to Columbus, you can go to everywhere. Man has a capability to go, man goes and explores. And so I'm not the least bit bothered about the thought that men would not go. I know men will go into space.
At the moment, though, that is only hope, isn't it?
It is so born into man, it is part of his makeup of the genes of man. It is his being is to go to explore and to search for the unknown, and man is going to do that.
If you don't get the space shuttle here, what happens to Cape Kennedy?
Oh, in 1974 or 5, we would only have unmanned launches, and we would then close down the center.
As simple as that?
As simple as that, yes.
So, only 10 years after the Kennedy Space Center sprung up from the Florida marshes, it confronts the bleak prospect of decline and even fall. The money and the effort have been spent. The space race to the moon has been won. America has proved herself, and now the hands that came together to produce the technological wonder of the century are dispersing. The people have other concerns. The Vietnam War, race, the cities, poverty, education, the economy, and the environment. America has put space in perspective. Lovingly cocooned, nurtured, and nourished, Apollo 16 waits through the final hours to Sunday, waiting to thrust its 50 tons worth of American prestige towards the moon. Meanwhile, we, Earthbound, will be told in increasingly ecstatic tones about the gimmicks and the gadgets, about the astronauts and their special new helmets, their new moon buggy, and the moon dust they're carefully carrying back to the lunar surface. We will hear little of cutbacks or rundowns. There will be no hint that the symbol of the greatest journey of them all could become an empty monument to a discarded ambition.